the thing that's I found so fascinating in my experience was how the stories that were being spun in court seemed to matter more than the actual evidence. Mm. And so, or even like, I was shocked that just my appearance and what I was wearing and whether or not I had my hair combed that day was reported upon so extensively and complete evidence that exonerated me or that was really important was overlooked. So I think that it's interesting when we talk about these cases and how they are in the public interest, what does that mean? And is it legitimate to say, well, people are clicking on it because I'm talking about what you look like and what you wear. And therefore, that kind of is the public interest. It's not really the truth. It's the story and it's the character. That was a really shocking realization for me as a 20-year-old kid who was going through this because, you know, I was 20 years old. I had very little life experience, like no perspective about the criminal justice system. I was traveling, I was studying abroad, trying to just engage with people and have conversations in Italian. And then this happened and I was given a very, very sudden and life-altering lesson in human psychology and the consumption of human stories and how that all plays out in the criminal justice system, which I never thought I'd have to think about before.
Yeah, or just to go back to what we were just talking about with Socrates, how much of it had anything to do with what he did and how much of it had to do with how he dressed or some weird rumor that the jurors had heard or just some vibe that's going on in the world in that moment.
How much is known about who the judges and the jurors were? Because I think it's interesting how in a lot of these cases, so much of trying to unravel why things played out the way they did, the focus is on the defendant, which makes sense. But also I think a huge part of this is who are the people who are actually doing the judging and the accusing? And I feel like that doesn't really get looked at quite enough, especially in a case like mine where I feel like, again, I was a 20-year-old kid. All of a sudden somebody broke into my house and murdered my roommate and then I was accused. And then so much time was spent examining me and putting every little moment of my life under the microscope as if to explain this, like what was happening, even those who believed in my innocence. And not as much attention was paid to the detectives or the town where this was taking place, the context, the prosecutor, what is his history? Some people looked into that, but I feel like so much of the attention was put on me as, and I felt like the explanatory burden of the wrongful conviction was put on me and my behavior or what I was saying or what I looked like. And I'm curious to know if there's more known in the Socrates trial about anyone else besides Socrates.
Well, that must have been a surprise for you as an American with the idea that it's sort of on you to explain this stuff when we're sort of raised with this idea of the presumption of innocence, however naive that actually is.
Right.
But here you are having to defend things that you didn't think would ever be known by people, let alone it, you know, be caught up in such a horrendous series of events. You're having to explain something that you don't know anything about.
Yes. And then having to explain really personal, private, you know, circumstances like this is what is in my toiletry case, including my little vibrator. Now I'm going to have to talk to the court and all of the world about my little vibrator that has absolutely nothing to do with the crime. And yet here we are talking about it. It was really surreal and frustrating that so many things that felt so irrelevant were used to prolong this trial and to support, again, like this idea, this story that was crafted like right from the very beginning before there was even any evidence at hand. And how that story stuck, like the story of sex game gone wrong was there from like the very beginning before anyone knew anything. And the fact that it stuck was the thing that really stuck with me because you know, you look at this crime scene, you gather the evidence, and here is a classic crime scene of a young woman who was raped and murdered in her own home by an intruder. Like, that's what the evidence shows. And yet, because this sex game thing was going on from the very beginning, this idea of a sex game, it stuck, and it stuck in people's imaginations, again, because of that sense of the public interest in scandalous stories. And I have never heard that phrase, every accusation is a confession.
Yes.
But I have.
That explains Trump in every way.
I mean, it explains also, I have had this like unsettled feeling that the people who were investigating me and prosecuting me also were like attracted to me. I have been really like disconcerted by the idea that maybe part of this motive, or like part of the fact that there was so much attention put on me, was because I was physically present in, like, consciously or unconsciously, there was something about me that titillated them, and that translated in the context of the situation to, oh, we're going to accuse her of a sex crime. Like, my little sisters, I have one little sister who is 100% convinced that this is psychologically at play, at least in part, if not consciously, then unconsciously.
Yeah, to me, the most timeless part of the whole story, you know, the through line between the examples we were just talking about and what happened to you, is the sort of the way in which events can take on a life of their own, and the way that human beings can sort of accumulate into a mob, into a frenzy. And that even in the ancient world, they're aware of this and trying to counteract it. One of the early Stoics, his name was Chrysippus, and he said once, look, if I wanted to be part of the mob, I would never have become a philosopher. And this idea of, like, are you someone who sort of joins in when the energy and the pitchforks and the sort of tide is turning, or are you someone who kind of comes up with your own view on things, who feels sort of either suspicious or feels a little uneasy when people are rushing to conclusions about stuff? And that kind of being two parts of the human condition, or two parts of human society, that's always been there. And although we can develop institutions that can mitigate it, the risk of it is always right there under the surface.
Sure. Especially since I think that it's a more sophisticated position, and maybe unnatural not instinctual position to feel uneasy about judgment, because I think that intuitively, instinctually, that is an automatic reaction. That's why we all love, or presumably we all love, sports. Like, that is the appropriate setting to have the mob mentality and to express it and to enjoy it, where nobody gets hurt, hopefully. Although even that can get crazy. I mean, the fact that, like, people can get murdered in a soccer stadium because, you know, they were rooting for the wrong side is indicative of how instinctual and how potent that feeling.
Yeah, that
is.
Energy is right there, and it just takes a couple little things to kind of get it, to break it loose.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And I'm curious to know, like, I don't have, like, I've never had the impulse to, like, punch a wall, right? I know some people have had that impulse before. I get it. Like, I've seen, you know, holes punched in walls. I've always thought that that might be a testosterone thing, maybe. But I'm curious to know, like, what comes first, the mob impulse and that impulse to, like, judge? Or is it the impulse to want, like, is it an aggressive impulse that then finds expression through judgment? Is it a chicken and the egg question?
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. I don't, because sometimes the mob thing isn't actually, even if what they're doing seems driven by anger, the individuals in it, they actually don't feel that strongly about it. It's that it doesn't feel real to them, right? Mm-hmm. So, like, a lot of what we would call, like, cancel culture, or like the people who are following what was happening to you, just passively through the tabloids or through the news, it was very, very entertaining, and maybe they had strong opinions one way or another, but what they definitely didn't think a lot about was what it would be like to be you or the families of the people involved, or anything, that it's, this is the same as a fictional television show, right, but it's not.
Yeah, I think that's really key. And it's one of the reasons why true crime in general makes me very squeamish, because it is a like morality soap opera that we all get to partake in, and all the people involved end up being ideas of people and rather than actual people who have real lives and felt experiences. And I don't know. I mean, a part of me is really sad that I had to experience that so strongly, that like I was an idea of a person in people's minds, and then that idea of a person was who they convicted and sentenced to 26 years in prison. But at the same time, it was me, real me, that had to go back in the prison van and had to go, you know, sit in a jail cell again for years on end. So that is, it makes me sad. And on the other hand, looking back in retrospect, I'm a little bit grateful for the experience, because it always, always reminds me that there is a distinct difference between what people think about me and what even I think about myself and what is actually real and what is actually happening in a present moment. And I mean, I think that's part of where my Stoic perspective comes in, where I don't get hung up on this idea of like my life depends upon what people think of me, or even my life depends on what I think about myself in this moment, because everything is an idea and not necessarily reality. Does that make any sense?
It does. And I even think about the stories I was telling you about. So Rufus, you know, he's like, I'm not going to defend myself, blah, blah, blah. I'm going to go into exile. There's something about even that where we obviously, everyone involved is long since dead, but we're sort of like, what a badass way to respond. And then we're like, but he's also probably married. He probably also has kids. There are other people affected by the consequences of this kind of like performative, you know, righteousness, right? And so I sometimes think about that too, is like, all this stuff was real. And there's like, there's sort of the symbol you, and then there's the you as a person. And, you know, hey, if you just accept this this plea deal, it'll all go away. And then you have this sense of right and wrong, so you don't want to do it. I'm not trying to imply about your case. I'm just saying we think about, you know, what the right thing to do is. And then obviously also there's how our decisions affect other people. There's the precedent that we set. So all this stuff, these morality plays, if you read true crime or you follow the news or you read history, and what it gives you is a very clear sense of black and white, you're missing the point. Because actually, the morality play, the Shakespearean drama of what's happening, should be teaching you just how fucking complicated and contradictory life can be.
Yes. And also that there are lots of powers at play. Like the person who finds themselves in the position of the defendant, the accused, is up against not just a person, but like a social construct, and is up against a history and precedent. And so them as a person, they're like, the person is who's going to feel the consequences. It's not the idea.
Yeah.
It's not the idea of the person. And yeah, I mean, it's fascinating to me that, you know, historically you think about the big philosophers and the big gurus, and you're not typically thinking about their families and their kids and how they're affected by what's going on.
Yeah.
And yeah, I mean, I think that's true also in my case. And it's true in all wrongful conviction cases, really, because the way that the media portrays it is that you, the accused, are this eye in the storm, when in reality, you belong to people. And those people's lives get put on hold or are put into limbo or are completely destroyed as they are dismantled as they try to like hold you up so you don't just plummet into an abyss of judgment and you know, punishment. And every one of those people have to rediscover themselves and redevelop their relationship with their role in the world, given the consequences that idea of a person faces.